Good morning. So our first morning, we had Sunday school classes. Some of our kids were here for them and some of our adults. It was great to have some people here at 9:30, and it was just a lot of fun, and hopefully this will progress. We'll just keep watch of how things are going and go from there. So we're just so glad, though, those of you who are here this morning are here, and those who are tuning in with us at home, we're just so glad you're here with us this morning. So our call to worship comes from Psalm 17, verse 6. I call on you, O God, for you will answer me. Give ear to me and hear my prayer. We're so grateful that the word of God is a promise to us as well as a declaration of who God is. Let's sing this morning.
God, from whom all blessings flow, praise Him, all creatures here below, praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Let earth and heaven
morning. So next Sunday, we're going to be doing communion. So for those of you that are at home, if you just want to get that prepared and be ready for next Sunday, the communication cards. So if you want to communicate to the staff, you can either Facebook message us, text us, or if you're here, you can put them in the offering plate at the back, then the offering plates. On your way out, if you would like, you could drop off your offering into those offering plates or mail them into us. Then my favorite announcement is this coming Wednesday, we're starting Wednesday night activities up again, which I am super psyched about. I think the teens are excited about it. I'm sure the kids are excited about it. It's just going to be fun. We're also going to be starting our small groups again on Thursdays. If you have any more or want any more information on that, just look at your bulletin.
Of the Lord forever, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord.
Our scripture this morning comes from Romans chapter 9, starting with verse 1. I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms that in the Holy Spirit, I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, those of my own race, the people of Israel. Theirs is the adoption as sons. Theirs the divine glory, the covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of Christ, who is God over all, forever praised. Amen. And it is not as though God's word has failed, for not all who are descended from Israel are Israel. The word of the Lord.
Spirit and take up. to share with you. My mother has come down with COVID. She's in a home. You know, that's a special need on my heart. But even more so, I have to let go of my mother. She's 98, almost 99. She knows God. She was a minister. She was an ordained elder in our church. She doesn't remember a lot of stuff sometimes, doesn't remember who I am. One day I went and waved at her through the window of her place, and she says, "There's a man outside looking inside of me." But, you know, in this state that we're in, I ask that you just pray for peace for her. Not, she's ready to go home. She's been ready for a long time. So, just remember for our letting go and saying, "It's okay, Mom. Grandma, it's okay."
If I could have you guys bow your heads and we're going to just say a word of prayer. Dear Abba Father, I just thank you for this day, and I just thank you for each and every person that's here and each and every person that's joining us on Facebook, Father God. And I just pray that you'd be with all the struggles that are going on in our lives, Father. I just pray that we would just feel you carrying us through those struggles. I just pray that you would just be with our loved ones who are about to come see you, be with our family members that don't know you, Father God, and I just pray that through all this they would come to know you. And I just thank you, Father, for our church, for our family, for the love that we have for each other. And I just pray that you bless our church, Father God. And right now I'm going to ask our congregation just to say the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against you. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, kids, we are going to dismiss and go to children's church. So if you want to meet me at the back door, wave at people as you're going out. Since we can't do, shake each other's hands, I guess, let's wave at each other as Pastor Pat comes up and gives your sermon.
Today, from the book of James. But first, I want to address who James is writing to. And you can find the people that James is writing to in Acts chapter 8. So let me stop. I know there's a ringing going on here. All right. On that day, Acts chapter 8, verse 1. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church at Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him. But Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off men and women and put them in prison. Those who have been scattered preached the word wherever they went. I'll stop there with this. There's a lot going on in the world today, as I just read that passage in Acts chapter 8. You can almost turn on the news and you can see that it's difficult for churches today to get together. There are the mayor of Chicago has put police cars in churches' parking lots to stop them from gathering together on Sunday, as some have decided that they're going to go forward and meet together. You know, it's hard to say that churches can't meet together when abortion clinics and liquor stores and other places are deemed essential places to gather. There's a lot of confusing things going on in the world today. These people, they had to run for their lives. And James is writing to them and reminding them this is about their faith. It's about our reaction in our faith during times of trial, during times of testing. This is about something worth discussing. Let me turn here to James chapter 1 and read this passage. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like the wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. He is double-minded man, unstable in all he does. The brother in humble circumstances ought to take pride in his high position, but the one who is rich should take pride in his low position, because he will pass away like a wild flower. For the man rises with the sun rises with the scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossom falls and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich man will fade away even while he goes about his business. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. Consider it all joy. In the midst of trials, this is easier said than done. Even though you are surrounded by all these trials that are testing your faith, that creates a perseverance in you, it is making you stronger and more steadfast, hoping that it makes you mature and complete. These trials are not a waste of these days of your life. This is something good, that something that God wants to use in your life. Most likely, what we are facing today is not close compared to what the people that James is writing to were facing in their testing during their time, making them flee for different places to live because of the trials that they were going through. A friend of mine's truck driver, he was telling me the other day, as we were in a Zoom meeting, he's part of our group, and he was saying that there's a sign as you enter into Texas welcoming all the Californians that are fleeing into Texas. It could have been here in Idaho. I hear there's a lot of folks from California, myself included, that moved here. But it said, the sign, the billboard sign said, "Remember the reason you are leaving California." You know, as the church was scattered in those days, they brought the word of God with them to new places. You know, testing is a term that was used in the purification of silver. They would put the silver into a pot, and then they would heat it up, and it would melt the silver. And dross, the impurities in the silver, would float to the top. The silversmith would come and scoot off all the impurities off the top that's floating there. And then he would heat it again and then do it again until he would look down at the pure silver, and he would look down and see his own reflection shining back at him. What a beautiful picture this brings forward, because God is purifying us. God is testing us. The idea here is that one day God could look down and see his own reflection in our lives, in our lives. Like we are becoming more and more like Christ. Mature, complete, not lacking anything. There's an expectation of God. The expectation of God was expressed through Jesus. And we can find this in, let me turn here to Luke. It's the parable of the sower. And this expectation is that we grow. There is a consequence in our lives that if we do not mature, if we do not grow in our faith. Let's read this passage here and see the words of Jesus here. Luke chapter 8, starting in verse 4. While a large crowd was gathering and people were coming to Jesus from town after town, he told this parable. A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell on the path. It was trampled on, and the birds of the air ate it up. Some fell on rock, and when it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and with it and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up and yielded a crop 100 times more than was sown. When he said this, he called out, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." His disciples asked him, "What is this parable meant?" He said, "The knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of God has been given to you. But to others I speak in parables, so that though seeing, they may not see, and though hearing, they may not understand." This is the meaning of the parable. The seed is the word of God. Those along the path are the ones who hear. And when the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved, those on the rock are the ones who receive the word with joy when they hear it, but they have no root. They believe for a while, but in the time of testing, they fall away. The seed that fell among thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures, and they do not mature. But the seed on good soil stands for those with noble and good heart, who hear the words, retain it, and persevering, is that word, persevering, produce a crop. The trials are going to come. The worries of the world, the things that are going to be out there to distract you, they're there. This is the things that we need to persevere with, persevere through. That is God's goal for me. That is God's goal for you. He wants me to be a reflection of Him. He wants to see, he wants to see me persevere. He wants to use the trials in my life. I should become more and more like Him through times of suffering. So often, it's preached that if you just become a follower of Jesus, all will be well in your life. Was anyone told that? I was. Just become a follower of Jesus. I tell you what, when I became a follower of Jesus, all kinds of struggles started to happen in my life. One was an awareness of the wrong that was in my life, the awareness that there was some correction that needed to take place in my life, a sense of guilt, a sense of shame. There was a pursuit that needed a cleansing, that needed, yes, Christ died for all these sins in my life. Yes, Christ died to wash away my sins. But there was something that needed to happen in my mind, a renewing in my mind. I had to change some friends. I needed to change some habits in my life. I needed to grow up, you might say, in my faith. God is not, and I might, you might want to talk to me more about this later. I say some things sometimes that you got to go, But God is not all about making you happy. He's about making you holy. He wants me to become more like him. That's his goal. That's his goal. It's through the trials, through the suffering, that makes me more like him. It makes me lean upon him. It brings me to my knees in prayer. If you want to be, your goal is to be more like Jesus. If your goal is to be more like God at the end of your life, I hate to tell you this, but things are going to get hot in your life. Things are going to get messy in your life. I was told, and I'm not a cake cooking type of guy, but I've been told that when you make a cake, all the things you put in it, like eggs, flour, and butter, you don't taste them individually. If I stuck my finger in the flour and tasted it, I'm not a big fan of sticking my finger in flour and tasting it. But if you mix them all together and you put them in the pan and you put it in the oven, and out comes the cake, something like that. Like I said, I'm not the cake cooking type of person. But that's what God does for us. He puts things in our lives, and if you're tasting them one by one, they maybe, you say, why? This don't taste very good. But God, he mixes them up in our course of our life. And through time, he brings out who he wants you to be, who he wants me to be. And I thank God there's many flavors of cake. I like them all, tell you the truth. I never had a cake I did not like. Now, Jesus wants us mature. He wants us to be complete, lacking nothing. In verse 4, we read, at the end of your life. These ingredients in themselves may not taste good, but let them work. Let them make you more like Christ. In verse 5, it says, if we don't understand, it's okay. Pray. I told some people this past week that I don't understand some things. It's okay. I was reminded, I was talking to someone just yesterday. I thank God for friends that call and check up on me. I think they're taking turns calling me and checking up. But one was talking to me, and he was saying some things, and I says, you know, I just don't understand. I don't understand why. But he reminded me of what I think it's called tapestry, where you people tie those little knots and I don't know, they make a little circle there and they stick the needle in and make, if you turn it backwards, it's just a bunch of like strings hanging there. It don't really make much sense or much of a picture of anything. But if you turn it around, you see this picture, this something that makes sense. Sometimes that picture is not going to be complete for us to see, for us to understand, for us to make sense of until we get to heaven. So in the meantime, I just have to trust. I have to truly develop this faith and trust in this faith in things that I don't understand and I don't see, and really grasp that and say, as was said earlier, give it to God. Give it to God. In verse 12, he says, those that persevere are blessed. They receive the crown of life that's promised to those who love him, who love him. He says, Jesus said, those who love me are those who do what I have asked them to do. There's a new commandment I give you, to love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. He says, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. I may have said this when I was a child. Mom, if you love me, you will get this for me. I believe my mom cursed me. She cursed me with the mother's curse. You know what the mother's curse is? The mother's curse is this, that your children grow up to be just like you. My daughter is not here today, so I can talk about her. But, you know, they would say to Lisa and I, if you love me, you would get this. Or, you don't love me because you didn't get this. You know, sometimes we carry this into our lives with Christ. And we approach God, our Father, in the same way in prayer a lot. There's this belief that Jesus is our sugar daddy, that he's our yes God. But sometimes the answer to prayer is no. This is not what's best for you. There's this country song, and it goes, thank God for the unanswered prayers. It was about this person singing the song, and he's telling the story in the song about how he broke up with his high school sweetheart. And he prayed and prayed and prayed that this would work out. Well, it did not. And years go by, he marries and he has his own child. And they go to his hometown and they go to a high school football game, and they're there. And he sees his old sweetheart walk by. And he turns to his wife and he says, thank God for unanswered prayers. Thank God. I'll let it sit there. Maybe there's some times in your life that you prayed earnestly to God. God did not answer. But there will come a time where you'll see the big picture and you'll say, thank God for those unanswered prayers in our lives. But it's through this maturity, it's through this growing close to the Lord, that we allow God to use these trials, these times, to persevere and bring us to the place that one day we will be somewhere where all the pain is gone. But for now, we have to persevere. I'm going to say something to those that are more mature in Christ. For those that are, I have to be careful with this because I'm getting there myself. For those who maybe have a little bit of gray that shows their experience of dealing with life's trials through life. Yeah, brother, you got a long way to go with that gray. but there's a place for you too. You may get a little older and say, I've turned it over to the younger folks. I've turned it over to the younger generation. The younger generation needs mentors. The younger generation needs those that have walked and have learned some things probably the hard way. I thank God for a special person in my life. After I had become an ordained minister, after I had retired from the Navy, I sent my resumes out all over, wanting to be a pastor in a church somewhere. I received some invitations to interview. And about that time, the church where I was stationed at in El Centro, California, at the Naval Air Facility, which was my last duty station in the Navy, they were in search for a pastor. And they invited a man named Dr. Barry Cunningham to be their pastor. At that time, Dr. Cunningham, he was suffering from from his kidneys were failing. His lost the feeling in his feet. He lost the feelings in his hands. He was losing his eyesight. And I met him at church camp, and he got lost at church camp. He got wandering down some path, and he went for a walk, and he got lost at the camp, and we met together, and we sat at a park bench on the church campground. And he asked me, he said, "What does that church want? What are they thinking, asking me to be their pastor?" I said, "They just love you, Doc." And he says, "I don't feel called to be a pastor." I'm going to tell you, he said, "Pat, what I feel called to do is mentor somebody. I just want to share with somebody one more time while my days are short. That's what I want to do." So he challenged me and he said, "If you come with me, would you be my associate pastor?" And I don't even know, that church has never had an associate pastor. I don't even know if they can pay you. But if you would be willing to come with me, I will share with you everything I can share. I tell you something. Being under the wing of Dr. Cunningham for 7 years was was much more valuable to me than, how can I dare say this? I'm going to get a letter from NBC, from the Nazarene Bible College. I'm going to tell you that there are some things that the Bible College does not teach, pastors. There are landmines in churches. There's politics in churches. There's things that go on, and I'm going to hear a pastor say amen here in a minute. There are things that go on that keep you on your knees that are not taught. There's not a class in that. You just have to somehow learn it. But it's through people who've been there, through people who have endured, have persevered, who have loved through challenging times, through changing times, that we grow. It says here they produce a crop 100 times more than was sown. 100 times more than was sown. You know, a lot of people look at this story in Luke chapter 8 about the parable of the sower, and they draw their attention about those that failed, those that didn't have root, those that were choked by the worries of the world. But if there's that one person that you can pour your life into, just one, I thank God for Dr. Cunningham and the things he poured into me. If we, you may say, well, I'm kind of older now and I don't have, I'm sure there's somebody you can pour your life into. You know, that one person could turn around and lead 100 people to Jesus Christ. You just never know. You just never know. Trust the Lord with it. Trust the Lord. God is not done with you until you cross over to glory land. God is not done with you because of age. I thank God for that. Persevere. Produce a crop. That's what God wants. He says, I will know them by their fruit, by what we reproduce. A lot of times that doesn't happen until the tree matures. That's good news, I think. Let us close in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, may I dare say, for the trials that are facing the church today. The church is blazing through very unique things, unique times, unique trials. This COVID pandemic, dear Lord Jesus, that has opened up a new world of watching church from our homes. But dear Lord, you have opened doors in many homes that probably would not have heard your message today if it was not for this pandemic, dear Lord. I know, dear Lord Jesus, that you can take these trials and bless them, dear Lord Jesus, for your kingdom glory. I lift up this church, dear Lord. I lift up the leaders of this church, dear Lord. I pray earnestly for the church board, dear Lord Jesus, as they have decisions to make, as they are challenged, dear Lord Jesus, as their hearts are heavy, dear Lord, may they lean upon you. As they seek your face, dear Lord Jesus, may they take their life's experiences and learn from them, dear Lord, and trust you in faith. You will not leave them or forsake them, dear Lord. May it be a time for unity. May it be a time of a oneness in spirit, dear Lord. May you complete the work that you are doing in our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Just a reminder that we need to be praying for our board as they are still making decisions and moving forward and trying to find a pastor. So keep praying for them. Also, as Josh said earlier, we will be having communion next week, so if you're home, be sure to gather supplies, and if you need help with any, just give us a call at the church, and we'll try to stop by and bring some to you. And then, finally, those of you in the sanctuary, make sure we leave from the back and move out that way after the benediction, and if you want to chat, that's fine. Just do it out in the outside. Give yourself at least 6 feet and be able to gather out there. So from Romans, "For I am sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Go and serve the Lord." Amen.